Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel and welcome if it's your first time. Today's video, I will be having a talk about the third episode of the Netflix show Shadow and Bone. Couple of things before we start. Number one, I have lost my episode 3 reactions. Also, the next video I will be doing is going to be an analysis of BTS's latest album V, since their new album is coming this July and I want to be ready for that album release. Also, I will be reacting to lots of K-pop music videos, so be on the lookout for that by clicking the notification bell. Now, let's get to the video. We left off episode 2 with Alina meeting General Kerrigan, aka the Darkling, him exposing her sun summoning power and taking her to the little palace to protect her from the hunters coming after her. We also had the crows meeting with the conductor, who will help them enter the fold and get on their way to Alina and in turn to the 1 million Kruger. Episode 3 opens with Alina having a dream slash vision of a big stag, which will be very integral to the rest of the show. The book readers know exactly what I'm talking about. Naturally, she's still dazed and confused, still unable to digest everything that's been happening to her. This is when a healer named Ginya enters with her helpers and start to clean up Alina in preparation for a meeting with the king and queen. Alina is both shocked and scared that she'll be paraded in front of the royalty, telling Ginya that she's only found out that she is Grisha a few days ago and she doesn't know how to deal, which in turn Ginya replies that Alina has always been a Grisha. She's only discovered it a few days ago. Also, side note, the actress playing Ginya looks like a red-headed version of Angelina Jolie. After they're done, Alina is taken to see the king by General Kerrigan, and on the way they have a conversation about her place, her destiny, and basically her fear regarding everything. And in reply, the general flat out says that as long as he's with her, she has nothing to fear. And oh my god, I'm in love once again. I don't care that he's a mass-murdering, all-powerful Grisha, he's bae. Yes, my love for the dark side is showing. Let me live. Then we have Kaz, Inej, and Jesper journeying with the conductor to meet his heart tender, who happens to be Nina Zinnick, also one of the main characters in the Six of Crows book duology. They plan to have her help them on their journey through the fold, but they're unable to get to her in time because she is kidnapped by a group of Grisha hunters named Druscilla. So the crows and the conductor take it upon themselves to enter the fold on their own, with the conductor giving them instructions to buy some materials that'll help them cross the fold. One of said materials is cute goat. This goat will be, I will be talking about the goat later because so adorable. Kaz orders Inej and Jesper to fetch the materials, specifying on Jesper not to make any detours, and in true Jesper fashion, he makes a gambling detour and loses all the money he was supposed to buy the coal they needed with. Like, why? Jesper, why? Y'all are preparing for a life or death journey and you choose to lose all the money given to you gambling it? Anyway, we have General Kerrigan taking Alina to meet with the king. There was a whole entourage in the court and the king asks to see her power. Of course, Alina doesn't know how to show it, but Kerrigan is with her and starts to manifest his own shadow, covering the whole room in darkness, all the while wrapping his hand around Alina's wrist, making her manifest her own power and making her summon her son. And when I tell you, I felt the tension between them. I mean it. I felt it in my bones. The tension, the chemistry, the overall atmosphere surrounding Darklina is insane. I cannot wait to see more of their scenes together in the upcoming episodes. The king and everyone is taken with Alina's power, and the king orders Kerrigan to have her trained in preparation for the war. Afterward, Kerrigan calls her perfect, because she is, hello, and gives her a flirty look, only working for Ben Barnes, because Ben Barnes, this show, Ben Barnes really came back. I'm going off track, simping over Ben Barnes, I am sorry, but this man is too much. Anyway, he gives her a flirty look before welcoming her into their entourage. Everyone else hugs Alina and congratulates her, and then, there's Zoya, who gives her a smarmy smile and hugs her, whispering that she smells of the orphanage and calls her half-breed. Half-breed. What are you, a Malfoy? God, I hate her. I hate Zoya so much. I hated her in the books, but the show is proving that I am going to hate her even more. I mean, she's no longer Kerrigan's favorite now that Alina is in the picture and she's butthurt about it. Like, go play in a corner or something. I'm getting heated. Later, we have Kaz carrying the goat and going to see Inej, who is standing before an obituary wall with the names of deceased people, checking if she would find the names of her family. At the very least, she wanted to know whether they lived or not, and when she didn't find their names, she told Kaz it's good. She has hope they're alive somewhere, which Kaz responds with that she shouldn't have hope because it would cloud her judgment and would distract her from their mission. Cruel, yes, but also very true. Like, sometimes when you set your eyes on a certain thing, any form of distraction would be very bad. Then we have Nina, who's taken into a dungeon upon a ship and is chained by a Grisha hunter named Matthias Havelard, also a main character in the Six of Crows duology, and we'll probably have more of their scenes in the rest of the episodes. Like I said before, I have yet to read the duology, so I don't really know that much about them. Next up, we have Kaz, Inej, and the conductor waiting for Jesper at the conductor's ride into the fold, which is a steam tank engine, and lo and behold, Mr. Jesper comes running away from a group of men for stealing 16 pounds of coal when he was supposed to buy 20 but lost the money to gambling. Like, really, man? Anyway, next scene, we have Alina entering the training ring and is told to choose an opponent by the trainer, whom I forgot the name of, sorry. Naturally, she chooses bitch-ass Zoya. The trainer asks Alina if she has had any training, and she remembers the time when Mal gave her light boxing training, and she bars with Zoya. And of course, Alina gets her ass beat by Zoya, since Zoya has been training since she was a child, and she was Kerrigan's favorite for a reason. But then Zoya, bitchface Zoya, has the audacity to mention Mal and toy with Alina, insinuating that she slept with him, quote-unquote, putting him on his back. As a result, Alina went mad, batshit crazy, and landed a punch to Zoya's smug face. And then Zoya uses her own power against Alina. And did I mention that I hate Zoya? I really do. Later on, Alina enters Kerrigan's library, and as she was perusing the shelves, she meets the apparat, aka the king's spiritual advisor. In other words, a cult leader. And he gives her a book about the saints of Ravka. This book is very important for coming storylines, by the way, so make sure to focus on it. Again, book readers know what I'm talking about. And yes, the apparat is just as creepy as he was in the books. Then he took her to an old woman named Bagra, who is in charge of training the powers of the Grisha. Also, she's very important to the storyline as well. Basically, every single one is important to the storyline, but there are certain characters that will shock all of you. She sees that Alina is confused and hesitant in regards to her power, and she tells Alina that the reason she was able to summon her power in front of the king is because of Kerrigan, because he's able to amplify any Grisha power he comes across. Non-book readers, take note of his amplifying ability, because it's important. And then she tells Alina to come back when she's ready. Next up, we have the crows and the conductor on their way through the fold, with the conductor ordering them not to move so as to not alert the Volcra to their presence, since Jesper didn't bring the specific amount of coal. And of course, once again, Jesper. Jesper drove me insane this episode. He moved, and the Volcra started to attack them. This is where the goat, Milo, comes in. He was brought for Jesper, calm him down, and it does just that. Jesper hugs the little fluffy goat, and Milo has a deep calming effect on Jesper, and it helps Jesper to balance his psyche, and he shoots every single one of the Volcra dead. Say it with me. Milo the goat is the real MVP. He's the real hero of this episode. I don't care. And if anything happens to him later on, I'm gonna riot. I'm gonna keyword someone. No one touches the fluffy Milo goat. And finally, we have Alina, who keeps writing Mal letters that probably won't ever be delivered unless she gives them to him herself. I really don't remember if in the book she wrote him letters and gave them to him or not. And we get flashbacks of their time together growing up in Bitch, I am. I'm gonna fall in love with Mal in the show. I'm gonna fall in love with him, aren't I? Because the actor is gorgeous, the way they are filming his scenes with Alina, the flashbacks, his past life. I'm gonna fall in love with him, aren't I? And that's the end of episode 3. It's getting more interesting and I can't wait to see how the relationship between Darklina develops. So that is it for today's video. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoyed it, and I will see you on the next one. Bye!